Hi, my name is Robert. This video is designed to give you step-by-step detailed instructions on completing the task at hand. Please read the comments in the About section of this video. It has valuable information and updates. My YouTube channel has a disclaimer video that I encourage you to watch. And please like, share, and subscribe. I hope you found what you're looking for. Thank you very much for watching. Hi, this is Robert. If you're watching this video, you've probably watched maybe my other battery versus alternator video, or you're having some kind of issue with your vehicle that you're wondering if it has a bad battery. So hopefully this video will clear that up for you. I'm going to explain to you some signs of someone having bad battery problems, signs of cable issues, and signs of alternator issues totally separated in this video. Okay, the first sign that you have a bad battery is you unlock your car door with your key and only the driver door unlocks. The passenger doors do not unlock. That's the first sign. Another sign of this issue may be you use your remote to try to unlock your car door and your car door doesn't unlock. That is a severely drained battery. Another sign that you have a drained or dead battery is that you get in the car, you turn the key, all of the warning lights light up. When you try to start the car, the lights may or may not go out, probably go out, and you hear nothing. No strong click, no cranking of the motor, or the motor cranks very slowly but doesn't start the car. So that's a sign that you have a bad battery because your battery is not strong enough to start to turn the starter motor. The starter motor is probably one of the strongest electrical things in your car. It takes a lot of amps and it takes a lot of power to crank that starter motor. Now, here's my vehicle going to a starting cycle. As you can see, there's 12 volts right there, and I hit the starter, that should drop as the car puts a strain on it. It dropped down to 10.7 volts. So, all because you have good voltage when you go to hit the starter, don't mean that that voltage won't drop as that motor pulls a strain on it. And it is hard to know what's happening with this system without a live voltage meter like I have here that you either plug into a cigarette lighter or that's hooked up to some other electrical lead or that's hooked up into your OBD2 port. See, here's the deal. You have a battery. Your battery has six cells. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You can have one or two bad cells in the battery and the other four or so cells could be good. If that's the case, you could put a voltmeter on the battery and it'll show you good volts. However, when you try to start the car, that battery is not strong enough to turn the starter motor because you have two out of the six cells are bad, or three out of the six cells are bad. So instead of your 600 cranking amps that your battery is rated at, you're now trying to start with 400 cranking amps, and your car may require 500 cranking amps before it'll start. So I get a lot of people say, hey, my headlights work. Well, your headlights may only need two good cells. They'll say, well, my radio works. Well, your radio may only need one good cell. The thing is, your starter motor is the strongest electrical motor in this car. And if that thing doesn't have 500 cranking amps, 600 cranking amps, 700 cranking amps, whatever is rated at for your vehicle, that vehicle is not going to start. So you turn the key, you hear a click. That click is the starter solenoid trying to turn the starter, but if you don't have enough power from your battery, it still won't make that starter motor turn. Now, one thing I have noticed with newer vehicles being vehicles that were made after maybe 1985, computer control with ECUs and fuel injection and stuff like that. A lot of times these vehicles build corrosion in the connectors, but it's not visible. You can't see it. So If you don't take these connections loose once a year or so and clean them out with the wire brush or whatever you would use to take the connectors apart and clean them, you could be losing a connection off of the good battery and don't have the flow that you need. So every once in a while, every year or so, you need to take all these wires apart, clean between the strands of the wires, put all that stuff back together, and then spray it with some corrosion protective material so that you have a good solid connection to your battery. Because there's a chance you have a good battery, but you don't have a good connection. Now, you have a negative cable. That cable connects to the battery, then it is ground on the chassis of the vehicle. And it may have another ground or two going somewhere else, another wire or two. As you can see, I got a wire off the top here going somewhere, and I got a wire going somewhere else. And those are going to two separate grounds. You might have to follow those leads down and make sure that they're clean at their connections. And it wouldn't hurt to take them apart and clean those connections and get that thing clean and solid. The same thing goes for the positive battery cable. There are four or five wires coming off of my battery cable connection. So if I'm having issues starting or running some kind of accessories in my car, I may have to take those cables apart, follow them to where they go, make sure that they're not broken, frayed, and have good solid connections, and clean the other ends of the connections. Another thing you may want to know about battery cables is the positive battery cable, the largest line coming off of it, as you can see there, the big red one, goes directly to the starter. It's bolted on the back of the starter. From the starter, it goes over to the alternator. So the alternator always has a positive lead off the battery, and the starter always has that positive 12, 14 volts coming off the battery. So those things are hot all the time, and they're grounded. So that's where that cable runs, among other places. Now, if you have a weak or damaged battery cable, the alternator will probably not be able to charge the battery like it needs to, and the starter may not be getting the juice from the battery that it needs. So even though you may have a good battery and you may have a good alternator, if your cable is old, damaged, corroded out internally or at the connections, you will still have starting issues and charging issues. The most powerful electrical motor in a vehicle is usually your starter motor. The manufacturer of your vehicle knows how much power that starter needs to first of all turn, secondly crank the motor. Assuming that your motor is in good condition, not seized up, when you hit that key to the start position, that starter motor turns the flywheel on the transmission and the motor and turns the motor fast enough to get it to start the car. Now, if for some reason, let's say that starter motor needs 500 cold cranking amps and your battery is rated at 600 cold cranking amps. Well, let's just say for instance that two of the cells in your battery are damaged, weak, or dead. Now that battery has 400 cold cranking amps instead of the 500 needed. It won't start the car. But if you put a voltmeter on it, it'll give good voltage. In that case, you've got a bad battery. It can't crank the starter. Now, if you're having starting issues or running issues and you suspect the starter, the battery, or the alternator may have some fault in it, the best thing to do as quick as you can is to take your battery to an auto parts store, because they offer a free service. They have high dollar equipment and they can hook your battery up to one of their testers and tell you if your battery has issues. Now, they have a hand tester that they come out, hook up, and that'll usually tell them if the battery's bad. But the very best thing to do is get to the auto parts store, remove the battery from the car, take the battery inside the store and let them hook that up to their gigantic testing and charging machine. Within 10 or 15 minutes, they'll tell you if your battery has bad cells or not. Because just hooking up a hand tester or a voltmeter will tell you if you have some good cells, may not tell you if you have some bad cells. Now, a couple more symptoms that I have experienced myself in the past of having a bad battery is, number one, turn the key, nothing happens. Number two, unlock the driver's door, none of the other doors unlock. Number three, I turn the car, it starts to crank real slow, then it stopped cranking. Number four, I turn the key and I could hear a ratcheting, clicking sound, but the car doesn't crank. Number four, I'm actually driving down the interstate and my battery is so weak that my car shuts off while I'm driving down the interstate. I reach down, put the car in neutral, hit the starter key, the car starts back up and continues to drive. That may happen for a couple of days before the battery totally dies, but that is a symptom of a bad battery that I have experienced. Number six, I'm driving along and my battery is draining and I'm starting to lose electrical things along the way until I lose my transmission controls or some other controls in the vehicle because the battery's getting so weak and dying. So those are symptoms of a bad battery. But again, the easiest thing to do is to remove the battery, take it to a battery shop or an auto parts store, have it tested, and replace it, especially if it's older than 2 years old. Now, you also need to realize that weak battery issues normally rear their head better in situations of cold climate. So now that winter is upon us or coming upon us, we're seeing more and more vehicles having weak and dead battery issues. So if you're going into the winter months, just have your battery checked and tested out, because you don't want to be 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks into winter and your battery dies, leaves you stranded somewhere. Now, when it comes to your alternator's job is to charge the battery while the vehicle is running. The alternator is normally under your serpentine belt. Down here, it looks like that little generator thing there. There's a couple of wires that come off of it. One is a sensing wire, letting the vehicle know that it is putting out the proper amperage or wattage to charge the battery. Another is the power lead to charge the battery. And another is more than likely a grounding situation that may have something to do with the mounting bolts. At any rate, if your alternator begins to fail to charge the battery, you will normally get lights in the dash indicating that the battery is not charging. You'll get one light maybe saying that the battery's weak and is dying. You may get several lights if the charging system is failing, is your alternator is failing and not charging and sending out the proper voltage or wattage. Now, there's a few things that can go wrong with an alternator. I know they have the voltmeter, or the voltage regulator rather, that regulates the amount of voltage that is sent out from the alternator. When there's no load, it keeps it maintained around 14 volts. When you have a load, it adjusts the amount of voltage sent out to keep it around 14 volts. It's not supposed to let it drop too low or get too high, because that, of course, will either drain the battery or damage the battery from too much voltage. It has bearings in it that helps it rotate at the proper speed and be smooth and not cause it to bind up and cause issues with your serpentine belt. It also maybe have some kind of diode pack or something in there. There are several components in the alternator that could go bad and give you bad alternator issues. Again, if you take your vehicle to an auto parts store or to a battery shop or to an alternator shop, they should be able to hook leads up to the alternator while it is still in the vehicle and tell you if that alternator is putting out the proper voltage that it's designed to. Now, if all this information still doesn't help you with your no start issues or whatever, man, you know, call a tow truck, have a vehicle towed to a shop or something that you trust, and let them deal with it. But again, I hope this helps you understand what's going on with weak batteries and bad alternators, and I hope you're able to make an educated decision on moving forward. If you feel that this information was useful, please like it and share it with your social media friends. You can subscribe to my channel so that you will get notifications of future videos that I post. You can follow me on Twitter, and if you need to contact me directly, please visit my website. And if you have any questions, leave them below, and someone or myself will reply to them. Again, thank you very much for watching.